We are absolutely delighted to have Richard Garriott with us tonight to introduce this evening's speaker. And I usually say a word or two about the introducer. I try to shy away from an introduction of the introducer, which would be too recursive even for math encounters. But I'd like to say a word or two, but the problem tonight is that it's really hard to confine oneself to a word or two about Mr. Garriott. So I will just have to say that he, like tonight's speaker, is an explorer of many realms. And so here, please welcome Richard Garriott.
Good evening, everybody. Good evening, good evening. You know, tonight you are in for a real treat because we are going to explore the limits of mathematics in a way that, having even been to a number of these math encounters, tonight is a very unusual night, one that I particularly am enjoying. For those of you who know me or have heard even a little bit about me, you may know that I am not a mathematician. In fact, my main business is the creation of virtual worlds. But I've used my success in the creation of virtual worlds to become an avid explorer of the reality in which we all live. In fact, I've traveled across Antarctica on a number of expeditions. I've been down deep beneath the sea at a variety of targets like the Titanic and hydrothermal vents. And I've even spent 2 weeks living on the International Space Station. And I did that, actually, my father is also an astronaut, so I'm actually the first, second generation astronaut. And so in a what seems to me a very similar way, you know, your speaker tonight, Dr. Golden, is my kind of mathematician. And what I mean by that is that, you know, beyond being a professor of mathematics and an adjunct professor of bioengineering at the University of Utah, he is absolutely a first-rate explorer. In fact, I happen to be on the board of directors of the Explorers Club here in New York, and I did a little research on him, and I realized he's not a member of the Explorers Club yet, and I need to help him fix that. And his mathematical exploration has taken him a number of times to both poles. He's journeyed 7 times to Antarctica, 9 times into the Arctic, all while doing mathematical studies of sea ice. His scientific instrument interests go beyond just sea ice. It's also climate change, composite materials, phase transitions, and inverse problems, which when I read that earlier today, I was going, what does that actually mean? But now, having heard the previous run, I go, I get it now. Very, very interesting. He's published papers in mathematics, physics, geophysics, electrical engineering, mechanical engineering, and biomechanics journals. He's given over 350 invited lectures in 6 continents, including 3 presentations before the United States Congress. In 2011, Professor Golden was selected as a fellow of the Society for Industrial and Applied Mathematics for his extraordinary interdisciplinary work on the mathematics of sea ice. In 2013, he was in the inaugural class of the Fellows of the American Mathematical Society, and he was given the University of Utah's highest award for teaching in 2007 and for research in 2012. An amazing list. His polar expeditions and mathematical work have been covered in magazines and newspapers, web articles, including profiles in Science and Science News. I know you're going to enjoy this. Please welcome me in joining in welcoming Dr. Kenneth Golden.
Well, thanks very much, Richard, for that wonderful introduction. And it's really a pleasure to have an opportunity to speak to you all tonight. The evidence is clear. Our climate is changing, and it's changing perhaps most dramatically in the polar regions. And I'm going to tell you how we're using mathematics, pretty sophisticated mathematics, to better understand the role of sea ice in the climate system and ultimately to improve our projections of climate change. And just so you kind of know what you're looking at here, because it might be a little like disorienting, like, hey, what is this? This is actually melting sea ice in the Arctic. These are melt ponds on the surface, and that'll come into play later in the talk. So what are we talking about? Well, we're talking about the cryosphere, namely the frozen portion of Earth's surface. And in the southern polar regions, we have a continent, namely Antarctica, sitting on top of the pole. And what dominates the continent is these great land ice sheets, which are 2-3 miles thick, of snow built up over millions of years, which then wants to flow as glacial ice toward toward the sea. But what we're most interested in is the frozen seawater surrounding the Antarctic continent, frozen sea ice, salty water in the Southern Ocean. As Richard mentioned, I've been very, very lucky to have been to both the Antarctic as well as the Arctic. My first trip in 1980, when I was a senior in college, was in the Western Weddell Sea. I think we were the second expedition since the well-publicized saga of Shackleton, that incredible expedition they were on. In fact, nobody was here, she killed in that thing. It's amazing. My second trip was again to this region. I've been with the New Zealanders over here in the Ross Sea and McMurdo Sound. And then, but most extensively, I've been off the coast of East Antarctica with my Australian colleagues. And the ship, the main ship that I've been on, the Aurora Australis, that will be in the video that you'll see at the end. Now, in the north, we have sort of the geographical opposite. Instead of a continent surrounded by ocean, we have the Arctic Ocean surrounded by continents. And the Great Land Ice Sheet in the north, of course, is the Greenland Ice Sheet, again, to a couple of miles thick of glacial ice. But it's the frozen seawater on the surface of the Arctic Ocean that we are most interested in. And as Richard mentioned, I've been up to the Arctic, I've been up to Barrow, the northernmost point of the United States, 9 times, although this spring in mid-May, I'll be going on an icebreaker up during melt season up into the higher Arctic, which should be very exciting. Okay, so why study sea ice? Well, yeah, it's melting, it's disappearing, but there's still a lot of it. It covers about 7 to 10% of the Earth's ocean surface. It forms the very thin boundary layer between the two principal geophysical fluids on the Earth, namely the ocean and the atmosphere. As such, it mediates the exchange of heat, gases, and momentum. Here you see heat or moisture rising up through the ship's track of the Aurora Australis. This is actually, you can't see the details, but that's the lifeboat of the Aurora, which we almost wound up in one time, which I'll tell you about at the end. Both the melting and the freezing of sea ice plays a major role in global ocean circulation. It's one of the main ways that that sea ice and the polar regions communicates with the rest of the world. And one of the most important aspects, though, is that sea ice is not only a very sensitive leading indicator of climate change, but it's also a key player. It's not just a passive bystander. It's a key player, an active participant in Earth's climate system. And one of the main roles that sea ice plays is in reflecting incoming solar radiation in the summertime. So this is measured by what's called the albedo, which is the ratio of reflected sunlight to incident sunlight. And whereas white snow and ice reflect most of the incoming solar radiation, with an albedo up close to 1, seawater, ocean, or for example, meltwater sitting on the surface of sea ice, absorbs most of the incoming solar radiation, so the albedo of water is actually down close to 0. Now, here you see a classic white polar ice cap with most of the incoming radiation during summertime when the sun is shining up there being reflected back into space. But the problem is if you start losing that polar ice cap, well, a lot of that radiation is then being absorbed rather than reflected back into space. Now, and of course, this is precisely what's happening, is we're losing the summer Arctic ice pack at a tremendous rate. This dotted line here represents the sort of longer-term average over from the dawn of when we started getting really good satellite data of sea ice coverage. This is what's being measured here is the minimum, the September minimum of the sea ice extent. And so this longer-term average is about 7 million square kilometers, which pretty much means that the entire Arctic basin, the entire Arctic Ocean, was still even covered by sea ice even in the height of the summertime in toward late mid-September. But clearly there's been a decline. It was a rather gradual beginning. Around the turn of the century, things started going south pretty quickly, no pun intended. Then in 2007, there was a record minimum at the time set. Things bounced back a little bit. And then in 2012, I believe it was on September 13th, in fact, it was the day before we left on our most recent Antarctic expedition, the extent in the of sea ice on that day was about 3.41 million square kilometers. So you can do the math. You can now make the statement that, well, going from 7 down to less than 3.5, we have now lost more than half of the summer Arctic sea ice pack. And I like to, and of course, what you also need to realize is normally you think of these kinds of major changes in hunks of the climate system occurring over thousands, millions, and so on, those kinds of timescales. We're talking a few years here. This is how dramatic it is. I like to show pictures like this because often, you know, the public hears, the Earth's climate has warmed by a degree or something over 50, 75 years, something like that, and we all have, you know, extensive experience with fluctuations in temperature, our own bodies, how temperatures fluctuate on a day. So it might be kind of easy to write it off, you know, or minimize the effect. But when you start to see graphs like this that, well, God, we've lost half of the summer Arctic ice pack in just a few years, that indicates that something serious is really happening. To put this in some geographical perspective, here's sort of the standard situation throughout much of my lifetime of the summer Arctic Ocean covered by sea ice. And then now fast forward to 2012, and you know, you see again, you've lost about half of this. Now what's particularly significant here is it's kind of like a double whammy. Instead of the entire Arctic Ocean being covered by a white reflective surface, well now, and reflecting that solar radiation back into space, well now you've lost about half of that, and so now you have a dark surface replacing it, and so instead of that radiation being reflected back into space, it's being absorbed by the Arctic Ocean, which warms the Arctic Ocean, which means you melt even more ice, which recedes even further, which means you warm it even more and absorb even more solar radiation. So it's this feedback effect, this what's called ice albedo feedback, and it's one of the dominant mechanisms that's helping to drive the precipitous melting that we're seeing in the Arctic. Now again, to put this in some more visceral geographical perspective, this area in red then translates to this about two-thirds of the United States right there. So we ain't talking Rhode Island here. Okay. Now, a few years ago, I've given a lot of public lectures on these kinds of things. Just a few years ago, 4 or 5 years ago or whatever, I was making the very dramatic statement that, well, boy, since 1980 or whatever, and over this relatively short period of time, we've lost the summer Arctic ice pack, the area equivalent to the United States east of the Mississippi. Well, there's the Mississippi. So you can see just in the past couple of years how much more melting we've seen. Okay, now, from a theoretical perspective, what's also particularly kind of dramatic is that what I'm showing you here is the predictions of the world's best climate models, the, say, top 20 or so climate models used in the Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change, the fourth assessment of 2007. And while all global climate models predict declines in sea ice over the 21st century, here's, say, the mean of all the models, here's sort of the standard deviation. But what's so striking here, obviously, is that what the theory is saying, the predictions are not capturing this incredible rate of melt that we're actually seeing. In other words, the actual data, the observations, are not matching up with the theory or the predictions of the models. And we see a much more rapid decay of the ice, actually. And so this presents a fundamental challenge. How can we represent sea ice more rigorously in climate models? How can we incorporate key processes that are maybe not so well understood? Say the physics of them is not even so well understood, or they're not even being incorporated properly into these large-scale climate models. And there's another fundamental issue here, this linkage of scales. In other words, you'll see in a few minutes, I'll give you a little bit of a primer on global climate models, and the scale over which the grids that they solve these things on are huge compared with the scale on which some of the important processes are happening. So this is a fundamental problem. Fundamental problem throughout science, certainly a fundamental problem in climate science, is how do you address these issues to ultimately improve our projections of climate change. Now in the case of sea ice, this is a particularly challenging yet fascinating endeavor, in the sense that sea ice is a composite material and exhibits a composite structure over 10 orders of magnitude, a so-called multi-scale composite. Now, when you freeze seawater, you can't incorporate the salt into the crystalline structure of the ice. And so it tends to reject brine. And however, what's left over is these sub-millimeter scale brine inclusions, which are laced throughout the ice. And this gives it its sort of composite material structure. Now, my background as a mathematician, I got my PhD at NYU, Courant Institute, just down the street, and it was in composite materials although I got my start studying that as an undergraduate, studying sea ice, treating it as a composite materials, and actually when I got to Quran, it was like, wow, real mathematicians actually study composites. I had no idea. How cool. So that's what I wound up going into. So, and then here's its polycrystalline composite structure, very similar to metals. There's these brine inclusions coalesce and form big channels. This is a monster channel here, like about 2 meters. Here's a littler one. If you take a cross section, you get these kind of these beautiful sort of drainage patterns. Here's pancake ice forming in the Southern Ocean. I view this as a composite with, say, meter scale microstructure. Larger scale flows, and now working our way up in scale, that's the Aurora Australis, the Australian Research Icebreaker, which is about the length of a football field. And then up to these scales here, so this is off the coast of Japan. This is looking from space, so this is hundreds of kilometers. And I view this as a two-phase composite of ice and ocean. All right, so what is this talk about? Well, as I mentioned at the beginning, how we're using the mathematics of composite materials and statistical physics to study sea ice structures and processes, ultimately with the hope of improving projections of climate change. Now, before I get into some of the more scientific aspects here, I will give you a bit of an introduction, just a little primer on global climate models, in some sense, one of the opposite ends of that, which is something to do with tipping point issues. And I'll also talk a little about more generally, like, well, who cares? You know, if all this ice is melting, why would we care? Does it affect us here in New York or Utah or various places around the U.S.? And then I'll discuss sort of fluid flow through sea ice and the so-called percolation process, where we'll do a cool little demonstration here that you all will be involved in, forming a percolation cluster. And we'll talk a little about how we monitor all these transitions in the microstructure and the porous microstructure of the sea ice, some of the experiments we're doing in the Arctic and Antarctic, and then taking these same ideas again to larger scales and looking at like that initial photo I showed you of the fractal geometry of Arctic meltpots. Now, some of the key concepts that will come up, critical behavior. I mean, this is inherent in the system. What I mean by critical behavior is where you can, small changes in a parameter in the system can induce rather large changes in the overall or effective properties. And this, of course, is inherent, just the freezing of ice. It's tiny changes in temperature can mean it's a solid or a liquid and so on. But there are a lot of other kinds of transitions that occur like this critical behavior. Linkage of scales, again, this issue of, well, how do you take information that you know about the ice pack or about the composite materials, sea ice on really small scales, and then, quote, upscale that to get rigorous information about the overall or effective properties, which is, of course, what is most relevant in these large-scale climate models. And then something that I think is particularly illustrative of the power of mathematics, and that's what I like to call cross-pollination, where we take ideas and techniques from seemingly completely unrelated areas of science and engineering, but of course the underlying mathematics is the same. And so we apply that to sea ice, or vice versa, where we take ideas and methods that we've developed to study sea ice and apply it to some other seemingly unrelated area of science, engineering, or medicine. Ultimately, what we're interested in is developing more rigorous representations of sea ice and climate models, which is currently treated in a rather rudimentary and inadequate fashion. Now, just to give you a glimpse as to where I'm coming from and where this all kind of goes in some sense is, so on the left, I'm showing you a thin silver film with, I think this is about half a micron, that bar is about half a micron, and one is interested, and this was originally, I think, looked at in the context of solar energy production, and people are interested in the light absorption, light transmission, reflectivity, and so on, and which is all determined by the composite geometry of the silver phase, the area fraction, the connectedness, the size of the necks, and so on. Now, on the right over here, you see two pictures of Arctic melt ponds, which are probably on the order of hundreds of meters across. Again, completely different scale, but we're interested in the optical properties, the transmission, the absorption, the reflectivity, and so on. And again, what determines that? The area fraction of the phases, the connectedness of the ponds, and so on, as well as the size of the necks and these kinds of issues. So the point is that we have similar kinds of issues and methods over here for studying the physics of thin silver films, but we're going to kind of use those ideas to study these much larger scale structures in a very different context. Okay, just a word about global climate models. So these climate models are systems, very, very large systems of so-called partial differential equations, which are equations involving the derivatives or rates of change of functions that you're trying to figure out. They're derived from the basic laws of physics, chemistry, and fluid motion. As you see, this is a highly interdisciplinary subject in general to study climate science, particularly the way we do it, see? And they describe the state of the ocean, the ice, the atmosphere, the land, and their interactions. And here's kind of the rub, though. These equations are solved on three-dimensional grids of the ice, air, ocean, land system, but with horizontal grid sizes, even the most powerful computers today, these models are so complicated and so, you know, big to run, even on the world's most powerful computers, the finest grid size you can take is maybe 100 kilometers, 50 kilometers, 30 kilometers. But I've been telling you already about sub-millimeter scale brine inclusions and processes that are important for understanding climate on that scale. So again, this is a fundamental problem. How do you incorporate sub-grid scale processes into these much more coarser grained models? I mean, for example, look at this. This model here, you know, there's Florida, there's like three grid points. Well, there's obviously a lot more going on in Florida than what could possibly be represented in three grid points. And this is one of the challenges. Now, these big global climate models have, of course, their sea ice parts to them, the sea ice components. And then what are the key ingredients here? Well, one of the main ones is the ice thickness distribution equation. This combines both the dynamics and the thermodynamics of the ice. Not only do you incorporate growth and melting of ice, but the ice velocity field, because that's important, because you can actually thicken the ice, as you'll see later in the video, which had major consequences for our expedition. When the ice starts, you know, crunching together, it gets much thicker. So it's not like the ice grew, but the ice is much thicker because of crunching together and ridges and so on. So this all has to be incorporated into, this is a very complicated nonlinear equation, actually. This is conservation of momentum, basically force equals mass times acceleration, F equals ma for sea ice, and again, there are lots of different forces involved in this, such as as the ice moves, the drag from the ocean, the drag from the air, the atmosphere above, and so on. So this is, you know, I don't write this down, because it can get pretty complicated. And the heat equation of snow and ice, which couples the thermal field, the temperature field, of the atmosphere above the ocean below, but through the sea ice. Okay, now, on a completely different scale in some sense, so you know these massive global climate models are, you know, I don't know how many lines of code there are, but you know, probably on the order of hundreds of thousands, if not millions, of lines of code with, you know, so many equations. In other words, it's all the bells and whistles of the climate, all the physics trying to be incorporated into these complicated models that are run on the world's most powerful computers. But there have been also other kinds of questions raised about tipping points, and it's made its way into the mainstream. So there's been, as I said, increasing emphasis in recent years on the idea of tipping points in the climate system, with the loss of the summer Arctic sea ice receiving a particular attention. Now, just to describe what a tipping point is, you know, you have like maybe a platform with a bottle on top, and then you want to tilt it. Okay, so I'll do it here for you. I used to have like a piece of cardboard with a polar bear on it, but I didn't. Anyway, so you start tilting it, tilting, and then finally it falls. Okay, so that's the tipping point right there. But one aspect, which is particularly important in the climate system, is what's called hysteresis, or irreversibility, to the system. In other words, and you can easily visualize that here, so if it was reversible, we would go, it would just go down, and then it falls, and then the moment we go back, I mean, okay, so we go back a little bit, well, now it pops back up, and then we're back to where we started. So it's just completely reversible. We go forwards or backwards, it's the same thing. But that's obviously not happening at the bottom. We go over. Bottle tips over, and we all know that, well, the moment I start going back, the bottle doesn't just all of a sudden pop up. We have to go a lot further. Okay, now it popped up. I had to go a lot further to get it back to its original state. So what does that mean for the climate system? A tipping point in, say, Arctic sea ice would mean, well, we lose all the summer Arctic sea ice, but then to get it back, we'd have to get it much, much colder. In other words, we get it back to the temperature regime where we lost all the ice. Well, that wouldn't do it. We need to get it much colder. So that's the hysteresis or irreversibility about all this. And so there's been some very interesting research. It's a very active area of mathematical research on sea ice and these tipping points. So has Arctic sea ice loss passed through a so-called tipping point? Or in other words, an irreversible downward slide to, say, ice-free Arctic summers, and in particular driven by this ice albedo feedback that I discussed. There's a beautiful seminal paper by one of my colleagues, Ian Eisenman and John Wetlaufer, in Proceedings of the National Academy of Sciences, where, and again, this is why it's the opposite pole from global climate models. They reduce the entire Arctic sea ice climate down to a single differential equation, a single nonlinear differential equation, and then try to analyze that. I think it's incredibly interesting work, actually. They look for so-called bifurcations or splits in the solution. They find that the existence of a tipping point in the loss of summer Arctic sea ice is unlikely, but if we go with further warming and we ultimately lose the winter ice as well, that would be a tipping point. Now, there's a more, some of my colleagues at University of Chicago started including the effects, like if you lose the ice, well, you're gonna get more clouds and stuff, and they started going a little bit further down this road, and they found a more robust bifurcation structure that, well, maybe there is a tipping point as we lose summer sea ice. But then some geoscientists would have started analyzing this question and have noted that, well, even if you lose all the ice, it actually could recover quite quickly. But the bottom line is here is, there's no definitive answer to this. This is an interesting area of mathematical research. Some of these people that work that study these tipping point and low order models, or so-called toy models, they look at these global climate models and think, well, what can you possibly know from them? All you do is you turn a bunch of knobs. It's way so complicated, you can't possibly know. And on the other side, you'll see some of the global climate models look at these, how can you reduce polar climate down to a single differential equation? That's silly. I think both points of view are very useful. It's a complicated system. They both have their advantages and disadvantages. But anyway, I think that both of these points of view are quite useful and important. By the way, I should say that this notion of dynamical systems and these kind of analyses that are done here are related to the so-called the onset of chaos, or the beginning of chaos theory, with Lorentz and his simple differential equation model of the weather and the so-called Lorentz butterfly. So this is all connected. Okay, now with all these, with all this talk about losing sea ice and whether or not we pass through a tipping point or not, who cares? Who really care if we pass through a tipping point? Well, if you use the sea ice as your main hunting platform to feed, you care. And so whether the ice is hundreds of miles off the coast of Alaska or right up against the coast, it affects your life, obviously. So polar bears obviously care. If you live underneath the ice and you feed on the stuff that comes down, that filters down from there, from like the extensive algal communities that live in the brine inclusions of sea ice, you care. Now, this photo was taken in 1988, right off the coast of Barra. And this is ice that early. And the point of taking this, so this was like a big incident that happened. A true story where there were these whales that were trapped right off the coast of Barra. But kind of the point of showing this picture is, well, it ain't happening now. We're in a completely different regime. The thought of having, at this time of year, the thought of having whales stuck right off the Barra, just a little far-fetched right now. In fact, there's a movie made about this, kind of a B movie with Drew Barrymore and who else? Ted Danson. Cheers, and if you guys remember that. And anyway, so it's kind of a cool movie, and actually, I spent so much time in Barrow. I love this movie because a lot of the scenes are filmed in, it's the northernmost Mexican restaurant in the world. And it's pretty good, actually. And anyway, a lot of their plotting and everything takes place there. And anyway, in the movie's kind of cool in the sense that, these poor whales are trapped and everybody's trying to get them free. And so the evil Soviet icebreaker and the environmentalists and the oil people and the media, they all get together in a kumbaya moment and hold hands and save the whales, So anyway, it's kind of a cool movie, especially if you've been up there, and it makes a lot of sense. So, but anyway, Hollywood's gonna have to come up with other ways of other kind of disaster flicks associated with this stuff. So, anyway, oil companies care. About 25% of the world's undiscovered oil reserves are in the Arctic. And of course, as the ice recedes, it opens that up for exploration. And just a little anecdote, I've been going up to Barrow and spending, staying in this called the Naval Arctic Research Laboratory, kind of an old rundown dormitory that has a great, sort of sentimental value and so on. Anyway, it's always been just scientists there going out to study our sea ice and everything, or whales or whatever. And anyway, the last 2 years there have been oil workers there, basically getting ready to drill. So it's a changing dynamic up there. Now. Does it affect us? If you start messing with a huge hunk of the climate system, well, you're gonna expect changes in precipitation and temperature patterns, storm tracks, and so on. Now, one of the main reasons I moved out to Utah in 1991 was the amazing snow. I mean, it even says it on our license plate, so it must be true. It says Utah, the greatest snow on earth. And it's true. I mean, it really is amazing, but there are predictions and models that say, well, one climate model projects reduced precipitation in the American West. So, you know, are we gonna have to change our license plates? 20 years or something? You know, who knows? Okay. All right, let's focus a little on the microphysics, on the fluid transport through the porous microstructure. So it turns out that fluid flowing through the porous microstructure of sea ice governs an unusually broad range of both physical and biological processes in the sea ice. One of the most important is the evolution of these melt ponds. So probably the single most important parameter in the lowest order global climate model is simply, aside from how much radiation comes in from the sun, is how much gets reflected back into space. What's the overall albedo or reflectivity of the Earth? Now, if you focus on the polar regions, then the most important parameter is the overall reflectance or the albedo of the ice pack. And that's determined by how much open water there is, but also the configurations of these darker melt ponds. You know, if the entire ice cover is covered with these darker water versus completely white, it's a completely different scenario. And so whether or not these ponds pool up and grow or drain overnight, completely changing the albedo, depends completely upon what's called the fluid permeability, or how easy it is for fluid to flow through the porous microstructure of the ice. Now, also, for example, there, as I said, there's algae that live, extensive algal and bacterial communities that live in the brine inclusions in sea ice. And their life cycles are sort of controlled by getting nutrients percolating up through this porous microstructure. Another very important process is surface flooding in the Antarctic. In fact, this has actually played a pivotal role, and I'll mention it a little bit later, pivotal role in my own career, where seawater percolates up, floods the surface, and forms a slushy mix. And then that slush freezes into sea ice. So it's kind of like backward sea ice freezing, but it dominates in the Antarctic. It's a very important process. And it's all controlled by seawater percolating through the porous microstructure. Okay, so let me just slightly apologize for, there will be a few equations here, but as I said, the last presentation, I mean, this is a math encounter, so I guess you should expect to encounter a little math. And so here's one equation here. So this is the basic law called Darcy's law for describing slow viscous flow in a porous medium, where we relate the average fluid velocity is related to the pressure gradient, how much pressure is being applied to push that fluid through, with what I would call a coefficient of, say, fluid conductivity, where the denominator is the viscosity of the fluid and the numerator is the so-called fluid permeability tensor. Which it's a tensor, meaning, or a matrix, which means that you can have different ability to flow in different directions, which you do see in sea ice, because there's a strong degree of vertical anisotropy in the brine phase in the sea ice. And as a mathematician, as I said, my background is in statistical physics and composite materials, and in particular, the field of homogenization. So this is the mathematics for analyzing effective behavior of heterogeneous systems, such as composite materials. And again, this is sort of where I come from as a mathematician. Another word about homogenization. Here we might have, an insulating host as a background material with, say, conducting ellipsoidal particles, such as kind of like brine and sea ice. And here's, say, a homogeneous representative of that inhomogeneous material. And this homogeneous material is, what we want to do is find a homogeneous material like that which behaves macroscopically the same as the inhomogeneous material. Now, this is a complicated problem, and this is hard to solve in general, depending on the details of the composite material. But it's attracted some of the greatest scientists in history. Maxwell himself tried to compute compute the first order approximation, first order term, and an expansion of the effective conductivity of a dilute suspension of spheres. Einstein himself worked on this problem of computing the effective viscosity of a dilute suspension of rigid spheres in a fluid. Now, there was particular breakthroughs in composite materials research, particularly in 1962 with Hushing and Strickman. Up to that point, engineers probably, you know, sort of more trial and error, like put materials together and then see what they do and, you know, try to test them out. But it was at this point where these engineers actually started really applying serious mathematics to rigorously predicting what the properties of composites would be. And that helped lead to the explosion of the use that we all know today of composite materials in throughout industry and transportation, cars, planes, and so on. Now, one of the most important phenomena that we see in sea ice
is essentially what I like to call the on-off switch. And this is something that I discovered out in a storm in Antarctica in a very sort of pivotal situation. I'll tell you about that in a few minutes. And so roughly speaking, when the brine volume fraction, so the warmer the ice is, the higher the temperature, the greater the volume fraction of brine, of these salty water inclusions. So below roughly 5%, the sea ice is effectively impermeable, fluid can't flow. Above 5%, the sea fluid can flow through the ice, and because you have connected pathways of fluid inclusions, and it's increasingly so with ease with which it can flow with increasing brine volume fraction. Now, by coincidence, this 5% critical threshold corresponds to a critical temperature of minus 5 Celsius for a typical bulk salinity of five parts per thousand. And for obvious reasons, this has become known as the rule of fives. Now, so as I was mentioning, this really plays an important role in the life cycles of these algae, for example. So in particular, biological activity turns on or off according to this rule of fives. And here's some data showing a convection-fueled algae bloom. So this is like very rapid growth of the algae in some particular layer in the sea ice, being fueled by nutrient-laden seawater, convective overturning, just constantly being pumped through. And then this is during the fall freeze-up. So there's a critical isotherm below which you're permeable and above which you're impermeable. And on that day, right there, it passed through the bottom of the algae layer. From that point on, they were stuck with the nutrients that they had. And you can see how it really shut down the growth pretty rapidly. Okay, so why is this rule of fives true? Well, it ultimately comes down to percolation theory, which is sort of what I call the mathematical theory of connectedness. So we're going to do a little demonstration in a second on this, and you all are going to be part of a percolation cluster, I hope so. So anyway, let me just describe the model. So we say start with a two-dimensional lattice, a two-dimensional square lattice, and then we flip a weighted coin. A bond, so these are the bonds, the black ones are going to be the open ones. They're open with probability p and closed with probability 1 minus p. So here's an impermeable state, like p equal 1/3. So about a third of these guys are filled, but you see no continuous pathway through there. Really, and we're really envisioning an infinite lattice, actually. And then here, 2/3 of them are filled, and whereas it might be a tortuous pathway, but there is a pathway, and this would appear in an infinite cluster. The actual threshold is precisely at 50% or 1/2, where you first have the appearance, the onset of an infinite cluster. So we did this the last time. So what I thought we might do is we're going to try to build a percolation. So that's why you all have a dice or a die on your one die on your seat. Okay. So what we're going to do is we're going to actually try to go through these different situations. And actually this will play an important role in some of our electrical work as well. I want you to do is we're first going to do the 1/3. Okay. So everybody roll your dice, and then if you have a 1 or a 2, you stay seated, and if you have a 3, 4, 5, or 6, you go, sort of get up and maybe go to the corner room or go to the side, because we're going to try to see who's left and if we formed a percolation cluster. But we shouldn't, okay? Okay. Yeah, now we definitely have a percolation cluster. At least not on this side. There's a disc, there's a barrier here. But it looks like we're going to have to allow next nearest neighbors, because if we went nearest neighbors, it wouldn't quite work. But I think it will work. So now we're going to connect this up with the later part of the talk. We're going to pass an electrical current because we have this pathway. Okay, now don't get scared. But let me go grab the baton. Okay, so now everybody, I think we're going to try it here. You have to hold hands with your near, to make a connection, okay? So I'm gonna not give this to you yet, but you guys, I'll all hold hands, and then we're gonna go back to that corner person, so you can join with you to you, and then you, and then just keep going back to, so we form a hand pathway through there. Do we? Okay. So is everybody holding hands there now? And so now we're gonna simulate the process of fluid or electricity because now we have a connected pathway. So I want you to maybe stand up so they all can see what. Not that you're gonna get electrocuted or anything. But so we can all watch. Okay. So you want to hold it down there?
Yeah, that silver part there.
Okay,
now you're
hold
that.
There we go. Yes. All right. We have a connection. Okay. Thank you. So hopefully you all have a better feel now for percolation theory and what it means to have a connected cluster and a connected pathway through a very complicated labyrinthine type of system. So what was the first big mystery? Once I started thinking, hey, percolation theory must apply here. And actually, I should mention how I came to all this. I mean, as I said, I was out in a storm. Winds are blowing 60 miles an hour. It's about midnight, and all of a sudden. All of a sudden I see, this is in 1994 in the Anslux expedition, all of a sudden I see water just percolating up and flooding the surface. I mean, not like a fountain or anything, but just flooding the surface, and I just saw it spreading out, and it's like, and kind of in, I had spent the previous 10 years proving rather abstract theorems about percolation models, and plus I'd studied a lot of sea ice as an undergrad, and kind of in that instant I kind of realized, hey, I think this is a percolation threshold, because I knew enough about the geometry, the brine inclusions, and the temperature profile, and so on, to think, hey, I think a pathway just formed. And anyway, and so it wasn't like all of a sudden I figured out all this new mathematics at that moment. It was like I realized, hey, all this very sophisticated mathematics that I had been studying really could be important here. And so there was like a shift in my mathematical career at that point. Like, hey, I really started applying some of the sophisticated mathematics specifically to sea ice. But now the first big mystery though was, well, why does sea ice have its threshold at 5%? Even this is 50%, the two-dimensional square lattice, the three-dimensional versions of this, the percolation threshold is 25% or 31%, depending on the details of the lattice. So why is sea ice 5%? Well, it turns out it's what I call an excluded volume effect. In other words, the brine inclusions are not completely randomly distributed. They live on the boundaries between pure ice platelets. But you still want to be able to estimate, given the geometry of this material, you want to be able to estimate the percolation threshold. Ultimately, I'd like to be able to predict the 5% from the geometry of the microstructure. That's what we want to do. Somehow in the recesses of my brain, I remembered this picture, which is a so-called compressed powder. Big polymer spheres and little metal or carbon black particles that are squashed together. So you have conducting inclusions on the boundaries between insulating platelets. And it turns out that these materials were used in the development of so-called stealthy or radar-absorbing composites that they coat military aircraft with. And there was a beautiful percolation theory, a continuum percolation model, developed to compute the percolation threshold as a function of the ratio of these radii. You can get arbitrarily low critical volume fractions by making the little particles really, really small. In fact, they tune the stealthy materials to get to achieve the radar absorbing characteristics that you want by messing with the microstructure. And anyway, I realized that there was a striking similarity between the microstructures. I applied that continuum percolation theory. It wasn't even math. It was, I took a ruler, just took a few measurements of these things, and out pops 5%, you get a paper in Science. So, not quite that simple, but there was no math involved. In fact, it took another 10, 12 years for this to all play out. When I published that paper, I had no direct evidence that this was going on. I felt it and I thought it, but anyway, it took quite a while to actually really confirm all this. And of course, these stealthy coatings, they coat the B-2 bomber, even the helicopters that were used in the raid of Bin Laden's compound. They use these same kinds of materials. And because of this deep similarity with conducting inclusions around, with these insulating larger structures, it turns out that sea ice itself is a radar-absorbing composite. In other words, regular microwaves and radar waves from satellites, they get absorbed by sea ice, just the way radar gets absorbed by stealthy aircraft. And I mean, there's more to it with stealthy because they have the shapes and so on that play a role. But this means that that it's very difficult to get your hands on the thickness of sea ice. This is one of the holy grails of climate science, is to help gauge the impact of global warming, is how much is the thickness of the ice. It's decreasing. I mean, it's getting thinner. But again, there have been a lot of other kinds of methods that have been developed to measure the thickness of ice. Okay, now getting beyond the percolation threshold to try to describe the permeability of the ice as a function of temperature or grind volume fractions. This is the cover of Geophysical Research Letters, where we published a multifaceted theory for the permeability of the ice. Rigorous bounds, percolation theory, hierarchical models, network models, all applied to field data. Prior to our work, people would take photographs, like slices of the sea ice, and take photographs of the brine inclusions in the ice and try to figure out what they could about, you know, the statistics of the microstructure and so on. But you can't get information about conductivity this way or how it evolved. So we developed an X-ray tomography method where we can really make a digital map of the brine phase and sea ice and then study it mathematically. And it gives us an unprecedented look at the thermal evolution of the brine phase and its conductivity. And again, I like to look at this cover as homogenization in action. How does the micro scale control the macro scale and processes of importance in climate science? Okay, now starting to verify this rule of fives, here's some of our X-ray tomography. No pathways, one pathway, many pathways. We map 3D images of pores and throats onto 3D graphs of nodes and edges. And then we ultimately analyze the conductivity of these graphs as a function of temperature and sample size, and use what's called finite size scaling techniques in physics, ultimately to confirm this rule of fives, about 10 years later. Okay, now, there have been thousands of papers published on percolation theory throughout over 40, I don't know, since 1958, I think. Percolation theory was first initiated. And there have been hundreds of papers written on the various parameter, what are called order parameters, the basic functions of percolation theory, talking about the conductivity, the density of these clusters, and things like this. But I've never actually seen any data on the order parameters, on the key functions of percolation theory for a natural material. Part of it is, because it's so hard to control all these things. I mean, you can't turn a knob and change the porosity of a rock. But you can turn a knob, you can just slightly change the temperature of sea ice and dramatically change the volume fraction, the conductivity, and the sizes and geometry of these brine inclusions. And so, to my knowledge, this is the first thing I've ever seen, real data for the percolation order parameters. So this is the vertical correlation length, the characteristic scale of connectedness over which the brine phase is connected, and you see it diverges. It's basically becoming, in other words, connected over essentially extremely large scales as we approach that 5% threshold. Okay, now, sweeping a lot of lattice and continuum percolation theory under the rug, this is our theoretical prediction using percolation theory for the vertical permeability of the sea ice. There's the 5% threshold. There's a so-called universal critical exponent, which is associated with these classical lattice models, and it's kind of a long story as to why sea ice actually obeys this universal lattice value, which is kind of amazing, actually, but very beautiful, because then sea ice, has these similarities with these classic lattice models, in particular the transport properties. And then there is this, and this is not an exact value, this is like the best numerical estimate. I proved a lot of rigorous inequalities that have to be less than or equal to, actually. But then this scaling factor in front is not just some fudge factor that we adjust to make it match up better with the data. It's an actual parameter that we compute using so-called critical path analysis. Again, another example of cross-pollination. This theory was originally developed in the context of electronic hopping conduction in doped semiconductors. And we took those ideas and used some of our X-ray tomography to estimate what this parameter should be. And then we get excellent correspondence with the data. There's our theoretical prediction in logarithmic variables. There's the prediction, there's our data. You see we get excellent correspondence with the data. And we have another other range of sort of related theories that we use to try to predict permeability. Okay, now, how do we monitor all this stuff? How do we try to get our hands on this when we're not there necessarily, or through satellites and so on? And again, this is what we were talking about earlier about the inverse problem. So these are fundamentally their inverse problems, where we recover sea ice properties from electromagnetic data. And the key parameter here is the so-called effective complex permittivity. It's a complex number. The real part corresponds to the polarizability of the medium, and the imaginary part corresponds to its absorption characteristics. We're interested in recovering brine volume fraction, inclusion, conductivity, and so on. And by the way, this is a setup for so-called crossbar hole tomography, where there's four electrode strings that are frozen into the ice that recover the effective electromagnetic properties of the complex permittivity in that box. And then ultimately we invert that data to get information, but I'll show you that in a second. Now, this notion of a wave propagating through, like a radar wave propagating through the sea ice microstructure, might be hard to visualize, but what we're most interested in typically is the so-called long wavelength or quasi-static limit. What you're seeing here is a beautiful, one of my very favorite photos ever taken, of ocean swells propagating through a vast field of pancake ice. Now, these are long waves, and you see them, these are tiny pancakes, and this is very similar to composite materials. In other words, these long waves, they do not see the individual flows. They see some sort of effective, say, pudding skin on the surface of the ocean or something. And actually, we're getting into this problem now about looking at wave propagation characteristics from a composite materials point of view. I'm a PhD student starting on that now. Now, so how do we do all this? And I think this is probably the most mathematical or most mathematically sophisticated slide in the talk. And so this is something I was involved in, so-called analytic continuation method, going back to my first year of graduate school. And the idea is you derive so first of all, you treat the effective complex permittivity as what's called an analytic function, a special kind of complex variable function that has nice all the nice smoothness properties and all the nice things that you want. You derive this, treat the effective complex permittivity as an analytic function of the ratio of the component permittivities, epsilon 1 over epsilon 2. And we can derive these very powerful integral representations for the effective parameter. There's the complex variable, so this involves an integral, so if anybody's had calculus, you know what this is all about. So there's the complex variable that incorporates all the information about the characteristics of the two phases, the brine and the ice. But then this is a so-called spectral measure. It's something you integrate against. I won't go into the details of what a spectral measure is. That would take us pretty far afield. But anyway, all the geometry information is incorporated into this part of the integral. And then if you want to go backwards, you can turn this whole process on its head, where if given this integral representation, we can derive rigorous bounds, approximation formulas, all sorts of information about the effective parameter, given information about the microstructure. But then we can go backwards, do the inverse problem, what I call inverse homogenization, where you're given measurements of the bulk effective electromagnetic properties of the composite, and then you want to invert for and obtain, recover information about the brine volume fraction, the conductivity, and so on, via this spectral measure. Now, we've done a lot of work on this. I've done a lot of work in remote sensing throughout my career. This is some very tight bounds in the complex plane, like given certain information about volume fraction and the separation, to derive very tight bounds capturing the effective electromagnetic behavior of the sea ice. These are much more sophisticated inversions where I believe in composite materials theory, where given electromagnetic effective complex permittivity data, we can invert for brine inclusion separation information, which is very subtle information. And this actually shows, so this parameter Q is like the ratio of that little disk, the inside disk, and so on. And the point being that when Q is less than one, they're not touching. When Q is allowed to become one, they touch. And you can see here that as the temperature increases, our recovered Q value keeps increasing. So we're actually electromagnetically showing that the brine inclusions are in fact coalescing as the temperature warms up and so on. Now this beautiful and powerful analytic continuation method, one of my PhD students adapted this method to getting very tight bounds on so-called polycrystalline materials. And this is sort of what I call a two-scale homogenization process, where we numerically homogenize, we're given information on the brine phase in a given one single crystal, we numerically calculate its effective electromagnetic properties, and then we use information about the distribution of the crystal orientations to analytically obtain very tight bounds on the effective electromagnetic properties. And this is actually very interesting because you'll see in a few minutes that we're interested in the difference between classic columnar sea ice, certain crystal structure, and so-called granular ice, this more fine-grained stuff that we see in the Antarctic. And so we hope this will maybe help us to distinguish electromagnetically between these different kinds of crystalline structure of sea ice, which have very different fluid transport properties, as you'll see. Here's just some examples of other polycrystalline materials that our theory would then apply to. Anyway, just lots of examples, rocks and metals and so on. Okay, now here's another great example of cross-pollination where we have taken ideas that we developed for characterizing the porous microstructure of sea ice and applying that to characterizing and understanding the porous microstructure of bone. So here you see healthy trabecular bone, and this is older osteoporotic bone that is losing its connectivity. We can actually, these are spectral measures computed for both these, then we can then reconstruct the whole process. And ultimately, so, you know, in other words, instead of using our math to try to figure out what the volume fraction of the brine in sea ice is or how connected the inclusions are, we can use the same methods to help monitor the progress of osteoporosis in a human. Because after all, I mean, the math doesn't see the difference. The math doesn't care if it's bone or sea ice or lungs or brain or wood or glacial ice or whatever. So that's the beauty of math. Okay, so now we've taken the spectral measure idea, which is a rigorous way of incorporating local information, and applied it to these larger scales. And this is, again, sort of a stepping stone to rigorous incorporation of sea ice into climate models and tackling the scale issue. So here's sort of three sequences of the Arctic ice pack with more and more open water. Here we have a connected open water phase. And this is all, I'm not going to go into it, but reflected in the details of these spectral measure calculations that we have. Now, there's a very interesting an important area of pure mathematics called random matrix theory. So a matrix is an array of numbers. And so these numbers could often be chosen just from some random distribution, a random matrix, basically. And one of the key parameters associated with a matrix is what's called its eigenvalue, its characteristic value associated. It tends to give you a feeling for the action of the matrix and how much it stretches things in what are called principal directions. And so if you have a random matrix, you're going to have random eigenvalues. And there was a very important sort of conjecture in opening up an entire new field, started by the Nobel Prize winning physicist at Princeton, Eugene Wigner, who I actually had lunch with one day, which was pretty cool. Of course, I didn't know about this kind of stuff then. But so he conjectured that large, heavy atoms, so the eigenvalues in the context of atoms in quantum mechanics are the energy levels, so I'm sure you've all heard of in quantum mechanics, the energy levels of an atom, of an atomic system, or a molecule, like the energy levels of a hydrogen atom. And so the conjecture was, well, big, heavy atoms, that the spacing between their eigenvalues would obey some sort of general, universal principles, basically, that it would only depend sort of on the underlying symmetries of the problem. And in fact, so they introduced this so-called universal Wigner-Dyson distribution, where basically the eigenvalues or the energy levels kind of repel themselves. It's a very interesting phenomenon. Anyway, we've discovered this kind of behavior in the climate system through this key operator that we use to study composite materials. And so here you see disconnected melt ponds, and then the distribution, the probability distribution that describes the spacings of these quote energy levels, there's no correlation at all. They're completely uncorrelated, so-called Poisson statistics. Then as the melt ponds start to connect up and ultimately dominate, the connected phase dominates, there's a transition in the probability density over to this universal Wigner-Dyson distribution. And again, this is, you know, we've only discovered this numerically. We think there's some absolutely fascinating mathematics going on behind this, but something that we're trying to look into. Okay, another related problem, again, seemingly unrelated, the effect of diffusivity in the so-called advection-enhanced diffusion, tracers in the atmosphere or floating around in the water, buoys diffusing in ocean eddies, that's the Antarctic Peninsula, this is the Drake Passage. I've crossed this many, many times. It's one of the stormiest seas in the world. Diffusion of pollutants in the atmosphere, salt and heat transport in the ocean, or even thermal conductivity in sea ice, where it's not just diffusive processes, but you have fluid moving around, which helps, just like when you stir a coffee cup. You tend to speed up the thermal transfer, the cooling, by moving it around. You see that in sea ice as well. And anyway, the idea is this is the so-called advection-diffusion equation with a velocity field, U, and we homogenize this equation and get a new effective diffusion coefficient that includes the old diffusive effects as well as the impact of the complicated current field or whatever. And it turns out there is a beautiful Stieltjes integral representation that you can treat the effective diffusivity here as an analytic function of the so-called Peclé number, which measures the relationship between advective to diffusive processes. And anyway, there's an analogous integral representation that was originally derived by Marco Villaneda and Andy Maida many years ago. And then one of my students, Ben Murphy, and also Jingyi Zhu, we've now really been looking at this problem and computing diffusivities and spectral measures for sort of model flows. And then ultimately we're applying this, one of the things we're applying it to is looking at thermal transport through sea ice. Now, since we're talking about these special kinds of analytic functions, there's another completely different application of these similar ideas, and this is a climatically important region called the marginal ice zone, MIZ. And the marginal ice zone, heuristically, is the region, the outer reaches of the ice pack where the ocean affects it. Like the core inner pack of really heavy ice is not really too much affected, say, by ocean waves and so on. But these outer reaches of the ice are. And it's been hard. How do you actually objectively measure the width of this marginal ice zone? You see, it's a very complicated looking dragon type looking creature or whatever. How do you measure it? So anyway, one of my colleagues at University of Utah, Cort Strong in Atmospheric Sciences, he came up with what I think is just an extremely clever, brilliant way of measuring this, so one of the ways of defining the marginal ice zone would be 80% concentration on the inside and up to 15%. So it's a function that goes from 80% and down to 15%, but he assumes that it's an idealized concentration field, that it satisfies what's called Laplace's equation, which is the basic equation that an electric potential satisfies, like what you all were just feeling, you know, with the electricity going through. And anyway, then you take what's called the gradient of this electric potential, or even the steady state temperature field, and you get these fields. These are like the electric field lines. These would have been the fields along the wires that was connecting everybody, basically. And so then he goes and he measures, so this provides a unique objective way of measuring the width. So he goes in and he measures all these and then averages them, and then makes this amazing discovery that over the course of where we've really been experiencing global warming, the marginal ice zone has increased in width by 50%, which is climatically significant. Anyway, but again, this is a beautiful application of relatively simple mathematics to a very important problem in the climate system. Okay, so now some of the experiments that we've been doing to monitor some of these processes and so on. We've been developing electromagnetic methods of monitoring fluid flow and microstructural transitions. We've been making extensive measurements of both the fluid and electrical transport properties of the sea ice, and you see we've had a fairly extensive field program in the last several years, both in the Arctic and the Antarctic. Now, this is actually the cover of the notices of the American Mathematical Society. This is me doing, I think, the first permeability measurements in the Antarctic ice pack. I was told I'm the only living mathematician that's ever been on the cover. They usually only had dead mathematicians. They justified it because you couldn't see my face. I mean, 40, anyway. And so I like to call this my $1 million meter stick, because all my friends there would have all this really fancy equipment, and I would be out there with my watch and my meter stick, you know, drilling partial holes, and with all my Home Depot equipment, actually, because a lot of my stuff is actually from Home Depot. So I like to call what I do Home. It's been quoted in some articles here that, you know, he does Home Depot science. You know, so. Although we do have more sophisticated ways of doing these things now, actually. We got a hint of this in 2007. Here's the classic columnar ice that the rule of fives applies to. But then, and actually I had predicted this in my science paper, that for granular ice, you have a more random distribution of the brine inclusions and you would expect a higher percolation threshold. Anyway, we started catching a glimpse of this in 2007, but we got a much, much better, we got a great data set in 2012. We really focused on this. We have a fantastic data set that really shows that the threshold for fine grain granular ice is around 9-10%. And this has implications, because any of the biogeochemical models for algae or whatever, or all the snow ice formation models. In other words, there's a lot of models that will have to be readjusted because of this different percolation threshold. Also, we've discovered the electrical signature of this on-off switch for fluid flow. So pretty much the electrical conductivity of sea ice has been studied for almost 50 years, but nobody ever saw the electrical signature of my rule of fives. You'd think it would be relatively easy to see because it's such a dramatic effect. The problem was, all previous experiments that I knew about, they would like do measurements from the surface and they would inherently mix the vertical component of the conductivity with the horizontal component. And it's the vertical component that's going to display the dramatic behavior, because you're really connecting things up in the vertical direction. So I did the stupid experiment that nobody had done before, where you actually extract a core, lay it out, and then stick the probes in like this, so you can directly measure the vertical component. And then everything pops out. Here's data we took in the Antarctic. This is percolation theory. There's the 5%. There's the universal critical exponent. And there's the electrical version of our scaling factor in front. Then we looked at our colleagues' Arctic data, and it just fit beautifully. So anyway, so this then allows us, through other methods like cross-borehole tomography, to electrically classify various sea ice layers and their physical and biological processes. So this is before and after melt pond formation. And so the different colors correspond to different resistivity regimes, but then we can classify the different layers in terms of like, well, will it support ponding? Is it permeable enough for CO2 exchange or the buildup of nutrients and biomass, and so on. Okay, so then I've just mentioned, you know, some of the impacts and of melt ponds sort of on the electrical properties of the ice, and now let's finally, as the last component here, talk about fractals and multi-scale structure, particularly given the melt ponds. So for those of you who are not familiar with fractals, here's one of the nicest examples, the so-called Sierpinski gasket. You start with a triangle, remove the inner triangle, now you have that one's removed, now you go to that top triangle, it looks just like that, you remove that one, and just keep going on forever. So this starts out being a two-dimensional object, then you start removing so much that you actually get an object with a so-called fractal dimension, a dimension which is strictly less than 2, bigger than 1. Okay. So this is that picture I showed at the beginning, sort of showing what, you know, I look at this and I see kind of fractals and fascinating kind of geometrical configurations on the surface of Arctic sea ice. And now, so there's been a lot of sort of basic numerical work, complicated numerical models of melt pond evolution, kind of trying, you know, like global climate models, incorporating all the bells and whistles, all the physics, and in particular, one of the main ingredients for these PDE models, numerical models, is our permeability results. Because if you're going to model how melt ponds evolve, you have to know what's going on below, obviously. So that's one of the fundamental ingredients that goes into this. And this, by the way, this has actually already been incorporated into the next generation of climate models, particularly the ones that come out of Los Alamos. But anyway, I stepped back and said, well, are there universal features of the evolution similar to phase transitions in statistical physics? Because after all, the melting of sea ice is a phase transition phenomenon, albeit over very large length and time scales. So just a couple words about fractals. Here is a one-dimensional object, just a simple straight line or a simple curve, dimension 1. Start bending it up, you get a Koch snowflake of fractal dimension 1.26, and then the most you could have things wiggling in two dimensions would be so-called space-filling curves, which have a fractal dimension 2, like this Peano curve just keeps repeating itself on. And then even Brownian motion, which wiggles around so much. Okay, now, motivated by Lovejoy's work looking at the fractal properties of clouds by analyzing area and perimeter data, like in other words, you've got a complicated object, you can calculate the perimeter, and you've got the area. And for a simple shape, like a square, the perimeter goes like the square root of the area. But for a complicated fractal object, the perimeter scales like the square root of the area, but to some new exponent, and that new exponent is the fractal dimension. And we thought looking at those pictures, we thought we would see something very similar for Arctic melt ponds, but we found something much more interesting. So the moment Christel Honegger showed me this graph, I said, oh man, we got something really cool. Because the slope, this is logarithmic log of perimeter versus log of the area. The slope is the fractal dimension. And what I immediately observed was a bend in the data, which means like a transition in the fractal dimension. And so that data point right there is that simple Euclidean pond, that data point right there is a transitional pond that's trying to become self-similar, and that pond up there is a fully developed complex pond with a boundary which is trying to behave like a space-filling curve. This is a computation from that data set of the fractal dimension as a function of the length scale, transitioning from 1 all the way up to 2, its maximum, the biggest it could get. And this is centered around a critical transition point of around 100 square meters in area, in the area variable. Now, we also see a percolation threshold. This is one of the key phenomena that's happening, is disconnected ponds, ponds connected on the scale of the image, and then ponds that dominate the image with in a connected fashion. And we believe there's a percolation threshold. That's one of the things we'd like to find. How does it depend on the type of ice, the characteristics, and so on? Now, we've been developing a lot of theoretical models to try to describe all this. This one was done with Brady Bowen, who was one of my great undergraduates that I have. I had him as a freshman in multivariable calculus. I've had a lot of students work with me, you know, coming out of my calculus classes to do research with me, in addition to high school students. We'll see that in a second. So this is kind of a random Fourier series representation of the, like, the topography of the snow and ice. This is a level set that intersects it, which is kind of like the water level. And so if the topography's here and the plane starts out down here, well, there's nothing. Now you just start to hit the lowest peak, the lowest point, like here. Then you raise it up. They start to grow and they start to coalesce. And so this model is very simple in concept. But it also exhibits this transition in the fractal dimension and the kind of things that we're looking for. Another example of cross-pollination, where this was originally developed in the context of diffusion in turbulent plasmas. Okay, another model that one of my high school students, she started with me as a 16-year-old sophomore, I think, in high school. She now just started at Yale. I have two more this year. They're both winding up in similar places, Caltech or MIT and so on. So this is what based on a very important model in interacting particle systems and statistical physics called the Voder model. The idea there is, well, you know, if you're this person here, and well, you're, you know, if you're all your neighbors vote for somebody, you may or may not be more likely to vote for that same person, kind of depending on how you get along with your neighbors. And, you know, here the idea is, well, a square is more likely to melt if its neighbors have melted. And actually she was the first one, this high school student was the first one to come up with a beautiful model like this that she was able to show exhibited this transition in the fractal dimension as we were looking for. And then finally, we've been coming up with an easing model. It's one of the most widely studied model in statistical physics, developed to look at, describe the properties of magnets, in particular their Curie point. And this is what's called the Hamiltonian of the system, which is sort of the energy of the system, which is like this. So basically, you have spin up, in the basic model, you have spin up or spin down. You have an atom or an electron or something, you can spin up or spin down. You can align or anti-align, say, with an applied magnetic field. Now, my idea then was to, well, instead of spin up, spin down, do ice, plus one is ice, minus one is meltwater, or vice versa. This is just the most elementary version of the model. We have a much more sophisticated version, which actually incorporates kind of a lot of the physics of melting sea ice and water and so on, which actually gives really great results. But this was a big breakthrough in the sense that I was writing a proposal with Don Perovich, who is Mr. Meltpond. There is nobody on this earth who has spent more time, that I know of, that has spent more time in Arctic meltponds than Don Perovich. I sent him this image as part of our going back and forth and writing the proposal, and Don said, "God, Ken, that's so cool! You digitized one of my cool Arctic meltpond photos." I said, "No, Don, that's not a photo. This, what you're looking at, are clusters of magnetic spins that align with the applied field in the easing model." And he just thought that was just the coolest thing he'd ever seen. You know, he really loved math. He's not a mathematician, but really loved math. So anyway, and we do see the transition in the fractal dimension here, and so on. Okay, so this is another major area of research that we're trying to get into. So in conclusion, summer Arctic sea ice is melting very rapidly, precipitously so. Fluid flow through the sea ice turns out to govern a broad range of both biological and climatological processes in the sea ice. We're using mathematical models of composites and statistical physics to try to unravel the complexities of sea ice and its various processes, and ultimately to provide a path toward more rigorous representation of sea ice and climate models. And this is my own bent, as you've seen some of the examples of it. I think getting involved in field experiments is particularly important, particularly in terms of developing relevant mathematics. And that's certainly played a major role in my own career. And finally, we hope that our research will hope to improve projections of climate change and ultimately the fate of Earth's ice packs. And so I'm going to show you the video in just a second now, take you on a trip to Antarctica. But first, I have to thank particularly NSF and the Office of Naval Research, as well as the Australian government, the New Zealand government, and so on, University of Alaska Fairbanks, University of Utah, who's very, very graciously supported all of our work. I also want to specifically thank our Math Climate Research Network. So this is particularly for the young people in our audience here that ultimately might want to go into something like this. And so the National Science Foundation has recognized this is kind of an important thing to put resources in. We actually got, I believe, the first Division of Mathematical Sciences funded network, $5 million over 5 years, to bring young people into climate research. Often, young mathematicians don't know they have the expertise to try to address some of these big questions. And so part of the idea is to get young mathematicians interested and engaged in these kinds of questions. We have, I don't know, about 12 hubs across the United States. We have funding for postdocs, graduate students, undergraduates, even my high school students. And again, the whole idea is to bring young mathematicians into climate research where there just aren't so many people involved in this kind of work. Okay, so with that then, I want to now let you see what it's like to go on an exciting Antarctic expedition. But I should point out, it is a dangerous place, as you might expect. And so my first time with the Australians in 1998, about 2:45 in the morning, please don't be alarmed. I've been sleeping. Please don't be alarmed, but we have an uncontrolled fire in the engine room. Now, not exactly what you want to hear when you're in the Antarctic ice pack, particularly if you're a mathematician who somehow got there by who knows. A few minutes later, please don't be alarmed, but we're lowering the lifeboats. So there, it was kind of, I mean, I make light of it now, it was kind of one of these amazing experiences, and it's kind of amazing that nobody was killed because there was a fireball. And anyway, we sat on the ice for 5 days. The engineers jury-rigged a control system because the main engine was destroyed. The control room was melted. It was quite an adventure, let's say. I love this. My favorite headline was "Icebreaker Bruins." There's all this fire and ice imagery. We all have the T-shirt. Got the T-shirt. Been there, done that. Got the T-shirt. So these are just a few opening scenes.
Welcome back. A professor of mathematics and two grad students from the University of Utah are preparing for a hazardous two-month mission to Antarctica.
Well, why do they need mathematicians in Antarctica? Science and nature specialist John Hollenhorst is live at the U right now with the answer. John?
Well, they're heading out in about 2 weeks. They'll be shipping out on an Australian icebreaker that's steaming out of Tasmania. For one of these math whizzes, this is his 15th trip to the polar regions. Yes, he'll be crunching the numbers as well as crunching the ice.
So now back in Hobart, this is all the preparations for our big expedition. That's the home port of the Aurora. In fact, I'm going there on Friday, down to Hobart. So now we're crossing the Southern Ocean. Now, this is disappointing. I love big waves, so this was kind of disappointing for me. Here we are entering the marginal ice zone. In a beautiful, beautiful morning. These are these waves propagating through, these spectacular problem in Fourier analysis, actually. But they're very important climatological.
What do we have here? What are you trying to do?
Here's a multi-year flow.
They'll be sticking out on the CMS in Antarctica.
This is hypnotic.
And
I love this.
The idea is to measure the wave decay. Because we're interested in how the wave energy propagates in sea ice and how that affects the breakup of the sea ice, sea ice melt, therefore. Our sea ice plays a quite a big role in the climate system, and if we can predict how it breaks up and how it melts and how it grows, then we can improve the climate models, basically.
What did you study as an undergraduate?
Mathematics.
What did you do your PhD in?
I was applied mathematics PhD studying wave scattering in sea ice.
So what's been your favorite part of being down here?
I'd like to say the waves, but that makes me a bit seasick.
Here's more penguins. They're coming to warn us. So I saw the ice actually undulating up and down. I started telling the safety officer. And anyway, we had actually, and three of the people got stranded on the wrong side. I was on the first responders team, this incident response team. We had just been trained in the use of this bridge. First time it was used on the Aurora. And so they got there, they're getting saved. And then a bunch of us had to go out and collect a whole bunch of stuff. So there they are, they've just been saved. But then, just a few minutes later,
we're deploying the remotely operated vehicle. It's instrumented with 5 cameras, so we can look at the subsurface of the ice, look at physical features, but also can observe the biology. And my instrument, or the main goal, is really to measure under ice irradiance, or transmitted sunlight, and the color composition of it, which tells us how much algae there are in the ice. So we're working on algorithms or equations to relate biomass, chlorophyll, which is a proxy for algae biomass in ice, with the amount of light.
So now we're going to highlight some of our work, and there's a lot of behind the scenes heavy lifting, just getting 200 pounds of gear up the gangway and hauling this stuff around. That's me shoveling snow on the surface of the sea ice, which we have to do all the time. When it was a meter thick, that was no party, trust me. Like this place. I'm pulling up on it while I break it with this very specially chosen instrument. This bamboo pole.
From a garden shop. So,
okay, there we go. So now,
so the core is supposed to grab it.
Beautiful, perfect core.
But we had to develop this lasso method because often the core doesn't catch it.
So looks like we're
interested
doing
in the rate at which the water is coming up.
Piping and plumbing out on the ice.
The hole. This is to block the horizontal flow.
Got a pressure transducer down here, and then we have one that sits in the atmosphere as well. And by seeing what pressure it actually experiences compared to the outside air, we can tell how much water is actually in the hole.
We were always being visited by seals, penguins, and
this is a block of ice that we're going to put in this waveguide to do a microwave measurement.
So you can see that being a waiter at Olive Garden is one of the prerequisites for the job. So here's a big emperor that was coming to visit us. This is working in a freezer on
here
the ship
got,
in Antarctica.
The top of the ice.
For crystal graphite.
Which you can see these sort of round crystal grains. Then there's a transition at about 20 centimeters, where we see it's still looking fairly granular, or like snow ice, but we start to see it turn into columnar ice.
So here we're being visited by these little Adelie penguins, which are not as bold as the big emperors. But they actually hung out with us for a couple hours here, and then an emperor joined the party. Then we moved the party back onto the ship.
So the primary objective is to really get a good assessment of the full 3D topography of the underside of the sea ice. This is all going to feed back towards the holy grail of the sea ice world in terms of being able to monitor and assess things like sea ice thickness from remote sensing packages like satellites.
So now we're going to look at a laser scan of the snow surface. This is Gerhard Diekmann, a famous sea ice scientist, being scanned. And the ghost ship, Aurora Australis, which would be the Pirates of the Caribbean. Who knew that penguins slapped each other? And here's the mom disapproving. So that's a minky whale.
Mathematics is not the usual supply ship. Aurora Australis is stuck in heavy ice.
We got stuck
for the last
3 weeks, 1,600 nautical miles southwest of Hobart.
University of Utah.
No, we were the year before.
The media in Australia are reporting that the 50 scientists are in no danger, waiting for the weather to change. In fact, they're taking advantage of the situation, helicoptering off the ship to do studies.
So this is probably the only Halloween party, costume party on the, there's an alien right there, out on the Antarctic ice pack. Okay, now this whale did get stuck. He was there the entire day. Now you can see how amazing the ice is. There's the whale right there. The ice was up to 20 meters thick. Finally, a lead opened up, and that's 800 meters. It took 2 days of backing and ramming to get there. Now he's testing the temperature with his face. Oh, too cold. Yeah, there might be a killer whale or a leopard seal. There's super penguin. So this is a raw seal mom with her pup. So we were officially 2 weeks late. It kind of messed up the whole Australian shipping season for their basin and stuff. So we made the fastest crossing that I've ever made. 4 days across the Southern Ocean back to Hobart. So here's a leopard seal. They're huge. They're top predators out in the marginal ice zone, big swells. This was one of the greatest days of my life. A hurricane in the Southern Ocean. Massive waves. Just so cool. Now remember, this ship is the length of a football field. Look how it's getting tossed around. Don't get seasick over there. Now, that's where the next shots. I'm definitely not supposed to go down there, but that's where I took these. That's what I was looking at. And I finally got nailed by a big wave and got soaked. And so then we arrived back in Hobart on a beautiful rainbow-filled boat.
Well, thank you very much for your attention.
All right, we have just 5 minutes for questions here, Professor Golden. So if you got a question, raise your hand, and I will run on over and wait for the microphone.
Hi, Professor Golden. Hi. I have two questions. I lived in Alaska for years, so I keep up with what goes on there. This year there was less snow in Anchorage. They couldn't even run the ceremonial start of the Iditarod race. Less snow in Alaska than there was in New York City. We had the most snow for years. Do you have like a very short, non-technical explanation
of that?
It's
weather, it ain't climate.
What?
It's weather, it ain't climate.
It's weather. What I mean is
these, you know, like storms in the East Coast, you know, more snow in the East Coast. I mean, it's hard to take these isolated events and draw much larger conclusions. Although they're, you know, climate change is really the important concept or right kind of phrase in the sense that there's all kinds of changes going on in the climate that might seem counterintuitive to, you know, to global warming, you know, what we call global warming and so on. So I don't really have any specific comments on why there would be less snow in Anchorage, you know, but these kinds of things come up all the time, I guess. You know, as I said, like the big heavy duty snowstorms in the East Coast and or the polar vortex coming down in this incredibly cold weather, you know, in the Midwest or whatever. So you know, some of these phenomena have been and could possibly be related to larger scale changes in the climate system. But again, it's dangerous to try to relate specific events like that to a larger scale change.
I heard that the amount of salinity is also changing, and I was wondering how much of an effect that has had on the melt, that you know, the warmer it gets, the composition of salt changes. And is there, and also, is there different kinds of salts in the Arctic as opposed to the Antarctic?
Not really. It's really seawater that you're, I mean, I'm sure there are subtle differences in terms of the mineral composition and the specific kinds of salt and so on, you know, just around global oceans, I would imagine. The issue of salinity changing, I mean, when sea ice freezes, what determines the salinity of the ice, which ultimately determines some of its, you know, transport properties and so on, that's really more determined by the kind of the conditions under which it froze, actually. And so I'm not sure if you can relate, you know, these perhaps potentially larger scale changes in salinity. But then again, you know, it's got to have some effect. You know, certainly, you know, if things are saltier, you know, in other words, it's easier to melt and so on. And these things do affect like the percolation thresholds at the specific critical temperature. So what you're making a very good point. I don't know necessarily the specific implications.
Time for two more.
What is the geoscientist explanation for reversibility even after losing winter sea ice?
You know, I'm not too familiar, I'm much more familiar with the dynamical systems analysis and so on, but just roughly speaking, I think the basic idea is that I think they've done some simulations and so on. Even if you start that your initial condition is a completely ice-free Arctic, I mean, you can build up ice very quickly, basically. And so, and in general, it is true that the thinner ice is, the faster it grows. Just because, you know, in other words, to get that cold, in other words, right down to where it needs to freeze, basically. So there is that effect, and I think that's, in some sense, fundamentally, that's kind of what they're talking about, is it's really easy to, you know, when you remove all the ice and you have all this basically open water, you can freeze that very quickly, actually. So there's, you know, there's a bit, but again, this is all a discussion, this is all argument, and nobody has any definitive answers to any of this. Part of the problem is these subtle mathematical issues, such as tipping points and the existence of what are called saddle node bifurcations, and these kinds of mathematical phenomena, how do you investigate that in a global climate model? Is the global climate model subtle enough, or, you know, have enough precise control or whatever to be able to even address such a question in that context? You know, to kind of meld these two different poles together in some sense. And you know, I think there have been some people that look at these kind of things, but anyway. But the basic, as I said, the basic, you know, to answer your question, that's this: the basic effect is just the thinner the ice is, the faster it grows, and if you remove it all, you can get a very rapid bounce back. But I think, you know, I don't know if it goes much beyond that kind of more intuitive. But again, I haven't read those papers, and I'm not sure.
Do the melt ponds get created by both the seawater coming up through
good
as well as the melt?
Yeah, good question. That phenomenon of seawater percolating up and flooding the surface, that's primarily an Antarctic phenomenon. The melt ponds on the surface of melting ice is primarily an Arctic phenomenon. There's all sorts of speculation as to why that's the case. But generally speaking, you know, the melt ponds form on the surface, of, you know, from just melting snow and ice and so on, and you don't generally see a lot of this kind of backward motion that you do in the Antarctic.
We hope to see you next time. Let's thank our speaker one last time. Thank you.